Welcome, welcome, welcome. Greetings and salutations. Get this straight. Greetings and salutations, good people. Happy Wednesday as always, and happy but later Valentine's Day to everybody. Hope everyone is peaceful. Hope everyone is safe, having a good time as usual. Welcome to the Logic Lounge with Fleezy Jones, episode 13. I am climbing up them numbers, man. And this, of course, is brought to you by the one and only Block Legend 7. 13. Getting up there, man. I'll be at 20 before you know it. What's good, everybody? So with 13, what are we going to do? What am I going to do today? I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I ain't even got notes for it. So who I'm bringing today, who my guest is, this brother is extremely, extremely interesting, different dude, which, you know, all of my guests are like that. And I'm excited to talk with this brother. He is one of the authors on the anthology book that's out now. They're in the company of poets. It's a Valerie Lorraine production. And I wanted to invite him to the lounge to pick his brain a little lot with the little time that I do have on the live. So that person is Drewsguidetothegalaxy. And as I said, this guy is definitely different. He's definitely has an awesome energy about him. So I just wanted to bring him up and have a chat with him. So, of course, as always, people, I won't waste your time. I'm going to get him up here. Let's see here. Momento, people. Shout out to everybody who came in. Yo.
Hey, what's up, my man? How are you?
I am good, brother. I am better now. Good. I get to have a sit down with the man who has the guide to the galaxy. Oh, brother.
It's a work in progress, man. We're going to get there, though, one day, right?
Yeah. I believe it. Dude. I believe it. I definitely do. Well, first and foremost, man, thank you for coming to the lounge. Thank you for accepting my invitation, man. I absolutely appreciate you taking the time, because what many might not know, ladies and gentlemen, is Mr. Drew is a father. Liam has arrived.
He's here, man. He's here in the flesh. Yeah.
Two weeks
yesterday. So just absolutely just unbelievable. Yeah.
Am I in the understanding that first-time father,
you know? Yeah. So the whole journey has just been so wild. And during it, I was working on a lot of pieces for the book. So it just kind of all at the same time, you find out you're going to be a father and then get this opportunity to showcase some writing and whatnot. It's just, you know, in between just your normal life and trying to find the balance, right? You know what
yeah.
I mean?
So, yeah. 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 You know, reading the information that you gave me, man, in the questionnaire, I honestly feel this couldn't have happened to a better person. You know what I mean? Dude, you have an amazing energy. So to be a first-time father with what you got going on is absolutely amazing. Can you hear me good, brother? Uh-oh, you're muted. I can't hear you. Uh-oh, still nothing just yet. Nothing. I see the lips moving, but I don't hear anything. Nope. Malfunctioned, everybody.
We're back.
All right.
I have to wear the headphones. I used to work in a shipyard, so I'm like basically deaf, you know? So,
okay.
Yeah. Okay. So I try and use the headphones, but sometimes it's just the echo. Everything is just too much. So, So dad life is crazy. And thank you so much for your kind words. It's, can it come at a better time? Honestly, it's like, you know, I know the world has been so crazy last, I mean, I don't even want to say pandemic. It's been, you know, every generation have its level of crazy. And I feel like we've kind of been stuck in this patch for a while. So I told my partner, I was like, you start to become an alien when you stop watching the news. You know what I mean? So it's like, I've been focusing so much on my family and, you know, it's like, oh, it's nice to take a pause and be like, okay, well, hey, the world's round outside of a TV screen. So, you know, it's a little bit different.
This is what I'm talking about. This is what I mean.
No,
the difference, man. Yeah. That is dope. That's a dope outlook to have, period, with everything.
And you know what, man? I say this to so many people. It's, you have to have the intention to feel that way, right? Or treat people a certain way. Otherwise, you're just going to look at everything as shit. So,
yeah,
it's like, you got to protect your own energy and other people's. That's super number one. I'm no good to nobody if I'm, you know, my shit's not right, you know, and that's a struggle. Every writer, every artist, I'm like, why do we write? Why do we put out art? Because you have ebbs and flows in your life. So being able to showcase this is an outlet.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. This is a great feeling, brother, but I'm going to get into it, man, because as I said, you're absolutely interesting. So I'm going to do a little background. You're from South Orange County, California.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Born and raised, still there.
Originally born in Long Beach and moved down to South County many, many years ago. So I've always been in Southern California. My family backstory, my family's from the UK originally. So, you know, my people are all still overseas. We go back and forth my whole life, going back and forth to Scotland. So it's like grown up British in America is the best way to put it. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. So, just when I think I know it, that is absolutely interesting. And I want to break down your accolades, man, your belt. I understand you're a spiritualist, you're a writer, traveler, photographer, and filmmaker. Now, I noticed in that list, you said writer and not author. So that loops me to my first question. This book, the anthology that you're in, would this be your first project that's out?
Yes.
Drew's writing to
me. That's the first project that has been, you know, given that opportunity and that privilege, right? So taking that opportunity when Valerie, Lorraine, and I made contact on Instagram, right, through the community, you know, art and writing and whatnot. And she asked me, she's like, hey, I like some of your pieces. Do you have anything longer? Because most of the stuff on my page is like just food for thought. I take all of my pictures on my page. All my stuff is my own photos, right? So all the destinations and places I go. And when I capture a picture, I'll go back and look at it and I'll think of how I felt in that moment. And that's why I put my little quote on there and whatnot and just kind of make it, you know, something that anybody can grab. I don't want to be one-dimensional writing. So I don't put myself in the classification of poet or it's just overall writer, you know, really, you know, lyricist, that kind of thing. Okay. And so when I got asked by Valerie, she was like, hey, do you have any longer stuff? And I've had, you know, over 20 years of writing long, you know, just for my own self-healing, right? As we all do, is how you start. You don't start with any other purpose rather than putting expression of yourself down on paper or, you know, digitally or whatever. So I was able to send her some work and she was like, hey, I really like this. Would you be interested in being a part of this? And I saw the list of the other authors in it. And I was like, this is way out of my mind. I'm like a fan. So seeing some of the names and then looking at their work and a lot of these authors have just such heavy work and to be a part of it was just something that was really special to me. And the book itself is multidimensional. Like I say this anytime I talk about the book, I'm like, you go on a journey with the author in each part of this book, whether it's Violet Moon Poetry, which was on the show. Yeah. And it's like hearing her voice and how well she does spoken word. When I read her work in the anthology in the Company of Poets, I'm like immersed into what is going on with the artist, you know? So there's so much experience in these pieces and these authors that I was just blown away. So absolutely honored to be a part of it. So,
nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I love how you describe how you label yourself as a writer and not the author or poet. That leaves your door wide open, and I absolutely love that. I'm a man of wordplay, so
yeah.
When I hear that, that just captured me, man. So that is absolutely dope. So, man, I want to pick the brain of Drew's Guide to the Galaxy. My first question, man, what is the significance of your name? Because I noticed two things. With the IG name, it's Drew's Guide to the Galaxy. And the email is Drew versus
Galaxy.
The Galaxy.
Yeah.
Can you give me a little insight on that?
Okay, so the email, it was like, hey, I want it to be, you know, Drew's Guide. But that long story. So Drew's Guide really started off is like a running joke. I used to be a bouncer. I worked in like gnarly, gnarly bars here in Southern California, military bars, all that when I was younger. Worked in the shipyard, very blue collar guy, right? Left high school, didn't go to college, and just big time dreamer. So your dreams can take you all over the place. So Drew's Guide was always like, when I started bouncing bars, I could, like, you know, I've always been deeply spiritual and like an empathic, and you probably same, right? Artists have a way of like, you get a vibe off something.
Yes.
So Drew's Guide is like, yo, Drew's Guide thinks this dude's a dick or whatever it is, you know? So it's like, I've never read Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
Right.
I was like, that's not my, you know, so Drew's Guide was kind of like a running joke with my boys, and it turned into like, oh, Drew's Guide to Dating, or Drew's Guide to whatever it is, like Drew's Guide to How to Treat Your Partner. Like, it's just a running joke. So, and I didn't want, when I created the IG, I wanted something that encompassed all the style of work and art that I wanted to showcase, rather than being like, Drew's Guide to Poetry. It's like, well, you sound like a dick, bro. You know what I mean? I shoot from the heart. I don't shoot from a place of, I guess I just never wanted to put myself in a box. So the galaxy is that to me, you know?
And I got to make mention with that answer, brother. Like, one thing I noticed about you, you are not what I would, and this is for lack of better words, you are not the average poet, writer, author, any of that. When I went to your page and did my homework, dude, every piece that I read of yours, I can almost put money that it was from an experience. And yeah, that's something you can't buy. You know what I mean? We use imagination as artists, right? And yeah, and we mix the truth a little bit with that. But I can tell the video I used for your promo, right, for the show at the end, I had that. I thought that hit me so hard because it was real. There's no other way to say it. Like I say, when you look at the other poets, man, they kind of take you away from reality, which is a beautiful thing. And you kind of bring me back to reality and make it okay that I'm here, if that makes sense.
Yeah, you know, honestly, that is such a, that's a heavy one for me to hear, man. Like for real, like there's a lot of intention in what I create of being able to have an audience that has no bias, and there's no level to my audience in the places I travel and stuff, and the people I meet. I want to make it to where it's like, oh shit, you know what? I'm waiting for Drew to say something weird about politics or religion, or put an opinion on somebody that isn't my own. So it's like, what I mean by that is, I don't want to, you know, when I sent you the bio, I'm like a no, you know, I want to be a nomad in this world and visit every tribe that I can, and get, because I believe so much in the ability to, you know, you get back so much more when you show respect and just listen. It's like, be an active listener. It's like, hey, I don't know, you know, there's limits to everything. So to have an opinion rather than an experience are two different things.
Yes.
So Drew's Guide to the Galaxy is like, here's my experiences. And that video that you mentioned, I filmed that in India in December, and I was visiting some friends, and it just got into this real, like, a no ego conversation with another man, you know, where you're just like, hey, what moves you? And I'm going to sit here and I'm going to listen to what you're saying without jumping on it or well, I went to, you know, I'm a graduate of this place or whatever, or I studied this. It's like, no, I want to hear it from the source.
Yeah.
Like if I'm talking to an older person, I'm very older than me in any sense. I'm like, you know, they're from the future. A really good friend of mine told me that when I was having a hard time, and it's always rung a bell. He's like, Drew, what you're going through right now? He's like, let me tell you something. I'm from the future. He's 10 years older than me. It's like, he's already been through this shit. So, yeah. You know, it's like, take a seat back and kind of just a voice for the voiceless has really always resonated with me, because when I was younger, my generation, it was like, go to college, go do this, go do that. You know, you got it to be successful. And I'm like, well, if I, at the end of your life, if your success is built on a, like, possessions and a monument, then what are your memories? You know, what are people going to remember? It's like, fuck, you know, it's like, shit, that's cool. But for the same amount of money I could spend on a sports car, I can go and I can go travel somewhere and go meet somebody, make a connection, right? Or visit them and be accepted or do the best I can. You know, it's not all groovy the whole way, but it's, you know,
it's something. Yeah. Dude, you speak from the heart. I could tell. There's no lying to you, Drew, and I have to make mention of that. But as always, man, I'll forget your promo. Thank you for those just coming in. You are tuning into the Logic Lounge with Fleezy Jones, brought to you by the great Block Legend 7. And I am having an awesome chat with the mysterious and spiritual Drew's Guide to the Galaxy, man. And we're just picking his brain here. And I got the significance of the name, and you were mentioning your background and explaining that to me, and in the bio that you sent me, I noticed you use the word humble beginnings, right? I am a wordsmith.
Yeah.
So when you say certain things, that automatically lights a light bulb for me. So I was hoping to get a little more significance of what you meant by that. Is that like a poverty thing, a struggle thing? What do you mean when Drew says, I come from humble?
It's such a good question. I believe that, you know, I am obviously, you know, it's like every artist, you put out so much stuff, but then you're also, there's so much privacy, you know, and one of the pieces I wrote where I'm like, privacy is the new currency, you know? Mm-hmm. So being humble in my mind is like, hey, my family came over here with little to nothing. And, you know, it was always about, you know, both my parents worked and, you know, wasn't, you know, it's, you got to go through it, you know, when you're a kid. And it wasn't, it's just, you know, you get to a point when you're young and you look back on it, especially now being a father, I look back and I'm like, fuck, that must have been insane, you know? My parents coming over here with two kids from overseas and being like, fuck, we're living in Long Beach and, you know, we got to work our ass off. You know, my dad was taking, you know, riding a bike to work and taking the bus, you know. And then when I moved down to South County, in South Orange County, and I was around a lot of people that grew up with a lot, right? And I could see where that is a pro and a con, you know. So when I say humble beginnings, it goes back. I always say it's like, everything that I write and even my friends and, you know, working class, being from that, you know, where it's like, you're basically written off. Yeah. It doesn't matter. It's like anywhere in society, anywhere I've been in the world, it's like, there's a language where you can navigate the world that only the boys know is what you know what I mean? Like, it's just, you can go, if you're a bouncer or if you've swung a hammer, whatever, it's like, you don't have a choice but to be humble and respectful. Otherwise you don't get to stand up the next day. So learning that way, working in Los Angeles, working on construction sites when I was really young, left school. It's like, hey, you're going to be immediately, I'm working in South Central LA when I'm 17 years old. I'm working in East LA. These are the first places I worked, and learning from so many different cultures and being, you know, I was working in with so many different guys and I learned so much and I was able to navigate that way. That was my galaxy. And being able to navigate that world because of that one thing. It's like, hey, you don't fucking act up. You know, it's like that respect thing. And I really believe in that. And that's where the, you know, people that have a lot of cool shit. I know you're on Instagram, you see it, it's like people flashy. I'm like, it's always the cat that doesn't let you know what the fuck they got that come back and give it back to you. And I always say, like, do it for the boys. It's like, that's the shit that, you know, when you're a young man and you're looking for motivation, it's those people that didn't fucking showcase that. They put their hand out and were like, hey, man, let me put you on, right? This is a word that I use. It's like, I'm going to put this guy on. If somebody travels to a place that I'm familiar with, I put them on with my people there. You know, it's like, hey, if I can grant you passage or whatever it is, right? I just get so much from that service. So that's where the, you know, humble to me, it's like, yo, pay it forward. But it's not like, here's an Instagram video of me paying for this homeless man's McDonald's. It's like, bro, get the fuck out of here, dude. Nobody, like, the best charity work you can do is the shit people don't need to see. It's like, you know, if you've got time to set up all your shit and film it, it's like, this isn't authentic. So when I do a video, I'm doing a one take. I'm not fucking polished. I'm not sitting on a rented Ferrari that, you know, doesn't belong to me. And I'm not like, hey, bro, what's up? You know?
Yeah.
So, cause that shit to real recognize real. And it's just like, I think there's a lot of people in the world that come from that place, what I just said, the real world, that are overlooked. And if I can get my voice out there to groups or any sort of community of artists that maybe have some of those things, whether it's the same thing in any music industry, right? You got the hip hop guy that, you know, doesn't know fucking fuck all of the city, you know, or whatever it is. You're like, yo, this guy doesn't know shit. Yeah. And there's levels to it. There's Mob Deep, and then there's just garbage. So it's like, you know, it's the same thing. So, you know,
yeah.
And if you can showcase art to the group, that's how I connect my art to people. You know, if you're telling me, hey, I read a piece and it hit me. It's like, that's because what I'm putting out there is just how I feel in the moment. I'm not doing it for accolades. I'm not doing it to get paid. I don't give a fuck about that, you know? So
I love it.
Yeah. And like that's the last of it. Yeah.
Yeah. That and pardon for interrupting. The reason I asked that, I expected that, you know, I don't have expectations. Let me take that back. But your answer went past any expectation I could have, because the reason of me asking that is knowing that, and I didn't know that your roots came from the UK and came over into the States. So I ask that because when I think of South Orange County, right, I think of high end.
Oh, yeah.
And for you to come from the, and say humble beginnings and have that answer, I think that's something that people need to hear, because you're absolutely right. My brother Block always says a lot of this stuff that we do is smoke and mirrors.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? It's smoke and mirrors, and I look for the real. I look for the people that is okay with having bad days. They ain't gonna have a good day every day. You're just not.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You push through that, and that's what I see with you, Drew. You're different. You're
but different, like the cat, man. South County thing is like, okay, so I'm commuting to Los Angeles, and then when I was working the shipyard, I was working in Hawaii, so I was flying to Hawaii, getting my ass beat in the shipyard, you know what I mean? Swinging steel over your head all day, sun is blazing, and then come home, and, you know, obviously rent here is fucking expensive as shit, you know? And it's like, hey, to be able to enjoy it sometimes is really nice, you know? But it's like, hey, I keep my shit small, you know? I don't have a sports car or shit, you know? It's like, hey, keep your shit simple, stupid, and enjoy being it. Like, I took time off work, and it's like, oh, aren't you worried about? I'm like, no, I'm worried about not having the experience with my son or the time with my girl, you know? It's like, that's what I said with money. It's like, hey, I'm not building a fucking mausoleum here. I'm building memories. And it's like, how you're remembered when you're gone? I was like, we all know people that that are gone. It's like, what do we remember? It's like, you remember certain people. And I think that it's something that the old world taught me, right? Because that's why we think about these people that left such an impression, whether it's musicians, whether it's, you know, writers or activists, whoever it is there's a reason why people are still quoting Muhammad Ali, Bruce Lee, Malcolm X, you know, Abraham Lincoln, you know, all these people, you know, Albert Einstein. It's like all throughout history, there's been leaders that have taught us like, hey, put it all out there, fucking go all in. If you can't go all in on yourself and be like, hey, here I am, like, I'm okay to fail, you know, it's like, fucking, I'm putting my ass out there, but I don't want to be old as shit and being like, oh, I should have done that, you know? Yeah. So it's like, what are you willing to lose? If I can't lose everything, then, you know, I have nothing to gain anyway. So it's like, fuck. Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I have to say too, Drew, man, I love the fact that you're a realist, period. You're a realist. There's no bullshitting to you. So that leads me to a question that I didn't even write down, you know?
Okay.
Coming from where you come from, right? And you come to this high-end place.
Yeah.
It's safe to say you could have played Chameleon. Why didn't you?
What I mean?
Chameleon. Like, you could have adjusted. You could have been brought into the fold. So
it was so hard. Like, my dad, like, my pop's got a major accent, right? And my dad is just, you know, my dad is like one of my best friends, and, you know, seeing what he went through, you know, people be like, does your dad even fucking speak English or whatever? We're on a job site and somebody talking shit. And it's like, bro, you just an uncultured idiot, dog. You know, in my mind, I'm just like, the fuck? Like, huh? We're down, you know, that's what I mean. Real, recognize real.
Yeah.
And you just immediately go back to that tribal, like, don't fuck with me, you know? Yeah. And that's in every single person, man, woman, whatever, you know what I mean? Like, it's in every one of us and we forget it. It's like your roots, there's history in your blood, in your DNA, there's history there. And there was just, where my family comes from, that's just, it's that mentality, you know? There was no, hey, you can go do this or that. It's like, I was an artist so young that school just was fucking, you know, it wasn't for me. I couldn't handle the rules. I couldn't handle thinking that U.S. history took fucking 20 years of your life to learn or whatever, you know what I mean? I'm like, okay, the country's under 300 years old. I'm sure we could get through this and fucking, you know what I mean? So, yeah,
absolutely.
You know, experience was so important. And then I just felt it's in your, you know, I got to be around it. I got to be around the boys, you know? Yeah. So the places I go to, I'm not, here's me. Like, yeah, I have friends in Paris, all over Europe, and I love all that shit. I do. But I get something so much in me from being chasing that feeling that I get when I am around my tribe or my people, or the energy that you want to be around. It's like, if I go to a concert or whatever it is, like, you're around like-minded people. So when I travel to India and I can, you know, I speak conversationally Hindi, Arabic, and Turkish, and I speak Spanish, and being able to be like fucking grounded enough to be, hey, I want to communicate with you. Like, what's up, you know? Like, when I go to India, it's like, fucking people ask me if I live there, you know? And it's like someday, you know, when I'm retired, people be like, oh, that's crazy. I'm like, no, I'm good, man. Like, this is me all day, just simple. There's something to life. The simplicity in life is, you know, we're all chasing that. We're chasing a way to buy it. It's fucking right in front of you, you know? Yeah. So.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Dude, as I said, hey, people, you see what I see now. And of course, promo time, because I will forget. Yeah. Thank you for coming to the Logic Lounge, people. This is episode 13, brought to you by the Craig Block, Legend 7. You have not got with that man, I need you to get with him, as well as Drew's Guide to the Galaxy. I'm telling you guys, do your homework on him. The man has some things to say. Well, with that, man, I want to know a little more about the bouncing experience, man. What how did you get into that? Fuck. And what was that like? Because that's a different feel, bro. That's a different feel.
Bro, that is some shit that I, you know, it was funny. It's just, I think there's so much from my youth and stuff, you know, being young, and it's like pub culture is really big in the UK. You know, like, you go to the pub after work, you fucking with the boys, like, it's just, hey, this is your safe space, you know? Like, it wasn't like, I don't know, like, you know, just that old school community, But basically started working out in the gym. I was involved in martial arts when I was young. That was my outlet. And then I got asked by a buddy of mine that was a bouncer. He said, "Hey man, we really need some help. Can you come and help out?" And I was young. I was like 21, bouncing a Marine bar during the height of like the Iraq and Afghan wars. And it was fucking gnarly, you know? Yeah. And I saw so much pain and hurt from that experience in my life that, you know, dealing with the clientele that I was dealing with and the trauma and the stuff with the veterans that I witnessed firsthand, like it hurt me so bad, man, you know, in that sense, psychologically, it got just too hard. And seeing people die, you know, from drinking or whatever, you know, just being around that negativity can really take a hold of you, you know? And I think through my experiences, it's really given me, it's protected me a lot. Like the spirituality comes from having to learn to read people out of a necessity of fear, you know? It's like, fuck, it's like, hey, all these psychologists and psychics or whatever, it's like, bro, have you ever had a fight for your life or know what it's like to have a gun on you or somebody trying to fucking stab you, like over and over again, you know? It's like you start to inadvertently, like that's how I protect myself. So when I meet people, it's like I'm not acting like fucking Jason Bourne, you know what I mean? But you're aware. I can tell you, I'm be like, yo, this guy's a piece of shit, or this dude's sleeping around in his old lady, whatever it is. Like it's easy to read, you know, because when you spend enough time studying people in that environment where it's all strangers, I worked both sides. So I used to bounce and also bartend at the same fucking time. So it's like, okay, you're serving drinks and then there's a brawl going down. It's like, oh, hold on one second. I got to go jump in the middle of this and put my ass on the line for people that don't give a flying fuck about you. You know, the bar scene is terrible. Anybody that's still in it, like it's tough to get out, you know? So when you're doing that kind of stuff, it eventually, it'll take its toll on you, you know, and you got to make a decision. It's either the fear of missing out because you're in the scene. Doesn't, you know, you could be bouncing at a fucking concert venue meeting, you know, your favorite bands and shit. But sooner or later, it's like, hey, there's more important things to life. And, you know, I ended up meeting my girl and that was pretty much it for me. I was done, you know. I was like, hey, I'm ready to go because I'd be bouncing. And back then it was just dark times, man. So. Yeah. I got friends that are still bouncing and they're fucking, you know, I have one friend that's 70 years old, still bouncing at 70, bro. It's going to be 71 soon. Wow. It's like, that's the only, when I go and see him, I'm just like, fuck, bro. You know, it's hard. Yeah. And it's just like, hey, I got to do this at this point because I got to pay for my digs and I get it, you know, but it's, I just got to, I had to take myself out of it, you know, so.
I could tell that hits you a certain way, and that it's absolutely amazing to hear your response to that, because like I say, you are, to me, the more I talk to you, the epitome of looks are deceiving.
Know
what I mean? Because honestly, if I ran into you back in the day when I was younger, antennas would be up, not saying that it would just, I would watch because I, hey, watch that guy, you know what I mean? But talk to you and I'm looking like, wait a minute. You know what I mean? Like, this is not what I pictured.
That's just like, you know, and I talked to you earlier about like the comment, like about bridging that gap. And there's so much to that where, exactly. Because I was meeting, obviously, when you're dealing with military, you're meeting people from all over the place, you know, all over the country. So you're dealing with, and I didn't have experience with any, but because like I said, my family wasn't in other states. So it's like, I'm more familiar with the UK than I am Texas. You know, you understand? So
yeah.
You know, dealing with all these different people from different walks of life, it really matured me a lot, but it also, you know, you can recognize how there is just that here when you meet somebody and you're meeting it from a different place, right? Different culture, different tribe, as I say. It's like, hey, if you can find that boundary of respect, there is no fucking problem. It's like men's ego is what stops them from anything, you know? It's like, that's it. Whether it's women, it's like you're too, or if you're whatever, say you're, you know, hey, I'm single. it's like all that game bullshit and all that wasted fucking time. It's like, just be honest. If you can learn to be honest all the fucking time, like, your life will inherently get better. There's nothing cool about fucking lying. You know what I mean? Like, if you've got to lie, it's like, how long can you keep up with it? It's just too much. You know what I mean? And I was like, hey, I was a bouncer, but I'm like, hey, bro, I'm a really nice fucking guy. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. I ain't trying to be mean, you know? So it's that same thing. It's like, oh, do I want to put myself in that classification just because that's what you would assume? You know what I mean? I used to ride Harleys, you know what I mean? So it's like, okay, biker dude, mustache, what's up, brother? You know what I mean? Like, that's not who I am, you know? So it's like, but of course, you know, the way I look in South County, it's like, okay, you're a bigger size dude, you got tattoos, you know, you got mustache. It's like, fuck, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, bro, wait, like, this is how the boys look on the job site. This is what I was used to. I wasn't used to the guy with a button up fucking tie and, hey, bro, alpha. I'm like, what? You know, I ain't from a fraternity. We used to go to colleges to party. You know, that's what we did, was like, okay, find somebody that goes to UCLA or USC, and then you're going up there when you're 18, 19. You're just a kid, and you're just like, this is the shit, you know?
Yeah.
I was like, oh, hey. Yeah. You know, it's like the same thing. I said this to my friend. I was like, when I was a kid, I was like, you know what we did? We'd find the kid that had the trampoline. You know what I mean? We're going to his house. You had the pool. Or like, hey, bro, we're new best friends, dude, because we didn't fucking have one.
Yeah.
You got a BMX? Yeah. You got a GT Mach 1? I'm on it.
Yeah.
Didn't fucking have one, but I'm going to ride yours.
Exactly. You know? It's like, yeah, no, that's the truth.
Yeah, so it's that's like, the hey, truth. You know?
Yeah.
And I think when you get older and you come from that idea, like, my girl won't, you know, it's like buying shoes was so important to me when I started to make money. You know what I mean? Like, having, like, being like, oh fuck, I can buy that. Or, you know, you start to, I guess, buy stuff from the past in a way. I did, you know, I'd be like, oh shit, I really want that. I'm like, wait, that's out of style from like 15 fucking years ago, dude. You know what I mean? Like, what are you doing, bro? Like, dude, you don't need those. I'm like, but I wanted them when I was a kid, you know? So
And that's what it's about, honestly, man. It's about fulfilling your own. You know what I mean? And try to share in the midst of that. But this is dope, man. And that actually brings me to, you kind of segue me into my next question. When did you label yourself a spiritualist? And why and how?
This is why I was so excited to link up with you, man, because you just got that, just our conversation now, I'm like, oh, we're boys. After this, we're boys.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you understand what I'm saying? Like, it's
absolutely.
Like, it's absolutely. So, it's just like, oh, okay, cool. Like, I got spiritual, like, a lot when I was younger. I had, like, weird experiences with ghosts and shit like that when you're a kid, and then traveling. I got deeply, deeply spiritual, I think after my first time, and I would say when I was really like, okay, I need to move forward with this part of my life or showcase this, was my first trip to India. So that would have been 2019, was when I was really like, hey, something's different and I need to step out a little bit more. And what my biggest problem was, and when, you know, when you read the Bible, humble beginnings, and all this, and I told my girlfriend this, I was like, it's really difficult for me to understand the analytical world, because I've always been based in an emotional world where it was like that fight or flight, that like that primal instinct was just before the logical, or what was being told to me was logical. So I had such a hard time with it. Like, I used to trip out if I was getting mail or some shit. I'd be like, oh, I don't want to look at that shit. You know what, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I think that's something that it was really, I was like, this is unusual in the sense of, you know, my profession, everything that I was doing at the time. And when I went to India, I was able to be around some really cool sites and be around the energy of the people, the experience, and to really not buy into the experience, but immerse myself in something without any idea of what it was going to be like, you know. And it hit me so much on different senses, where I was like, okay, this is what I need to be doing. And then the first time I was really in the Middle East, same thing, where I was like, okay, like, keep going a little bit more, because everything that I was told about these places started to shatter around me. You know what I mean? It's like, it's like we all have this idea of how we all are, right? Culturally, like, okay, well, this is how it is in Chicago. This is how it is in Austin, Texas. But until you experience the experience of the real, recognized real part of that play, it's like all that other bullshit fades the fuck away. You know what I mean?
Yes.
It's like, I was telling, it's like when I listen to music in a place, it's super important to me. I'll put on my headphones, I'll listen to music, and you'll just get a vibe. You pick up that energy, you know? And it doesn't really matter what you're listening to, but there are certain, I'm sure, you know, if you're on a drive or something, you're like, I love driving and looking at stuff and like getting that vibe, you know?
Yeah,
so do. That's where I pick up a lot of how I feel. I'm like, there's no distraction. I can, like I said, I don't live inside the square box. The world is round. You know what I mean? So it's like, it's a continuation of just kind of going towards my own fears that I have, you know, a lot of anxiety, all the normal stuff that we all have, and being like, wait, like, there's a little bit more. There's a little bit more. As long as I kept going down the rabbit hole, it's like all I learned was it just continues, you know? And spirituality, you know, there's so many people that sell spirituality, and I write so much about that because I'm so against it, you know?
Yeah.
It's like if I can help somebody bring something out of them and be like, hey, I see this in you. It's like anytime I do spiritual work with anybody, I'm not telling them anything they don't already know. You know what I mean? It's like, I'm not going to be like, oh, Fleezy, in, you know, a week, bro, like, this is what's going to happen to you.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know? It's like just from talking to you, you just have such good energy where it's like, I know you and I are so similar in the same way where it's like, you have that don't fuck with me. Cause I was just like, yo, that's just how it is. But it's like, when you break down that barrier, it's like so much laughter and so much fun and so much like good-heartedness, you know, but it's like the people that you allow into your own personal circle are people that are like the mirror image of you. You know what I mean? Where it's safe like that. You finding your own people and bringing them towards you. So it doesn't matter where they're from. It's like you and I talking right now. It's like, we're people now.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree.
You know what I mean? Like, I mean, it's hard for me when I say like get in the zone when you're talking about these spiritual ideas, because it's like I can only when I talk to somebody, meet them, you know, like that video you posted in India. It's like, hey, that was from a conversation like you and I are having.
Yeah.
Like you would meet that same guy and be like, this is my person, you know.
Yeah.
That would be that's how it is. And I think the other people are selling you the subscription to spirituality. It can be really damning. You know, it can send you in a different direction. I'm like, bro, you're paying for somebody else's subscription and they're selling you the medicine. You know, it's two different things.
It is.
Like, self-healing, that's why I got into writing. It's like, hey, if I can put one fucking piece of work out where somebody reads it and it's like, shit, that helped me in a fucking dark time, that's worth more than anything. Because like I was saying, I'm like, dude, like money comes and goes. Who gives a fuck? You know, like it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And you get lost in that. So the spirituality is, I always say this, there, in order to believe in myself, I have to be willing to lose everything. And you got to make those sacrifices, you know, whether I did a piece where I'm like, you're going to have to sacrifice when you come, you know, come out as the person that you are going to showcase to the world, not your fucking profession. I'm talking about your character. It's like, if you're going to be your true character, you absolutely have to be willing to lose people to be it. Cause you can't sugarcoat. Okay. I'm Drew's Guide of the Galaxy with IG world. And then I'm Drew with, I'm somebody else with my family. It's like, I'm the same cat. It's just like, you have to be fluid in what you're doing. Cause otherwise the shit is just, you know, even when I'm on the shipyard or I'm working with my hands, it's like the boys know. It's like, yo, Drew's probably got crystals in his pockets. It's like a fucking running joke, you know, whatever. I'm like, hey, you know, like that's who I am. It's like, I don't go, if you're doing something, it's like, you got to be fluid in who you are and have the confidence to do it. Otherwise it's a fucking pipe dream, you know?
Yeah.
You know, even if the only thing you do in this life is be yourself, that's fucking money.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So sorry for the drawn out answer, but
No, please don't. Mm-mm. I won't even allow you to censor yourself with that, brother. No, that was beautiful. That was beautiful. Which brings me, you keep segwaying. And thank you, everybody. A-double-M. Hey, Lynn, how y'all doing? Thank you for coming into the Logic Lounge with Fleezy Jones, brought to you by the man, Block Legend 7. Get with him. We are speaking with Drew's Guide to the Galaxy. This dude is awesome. So now that we're wrapping up towards the end, you are segueing. Dude, you're making this easy for me. So let's talk about the travel, right?
Yeah.
And I understand, and for those who don't know about Mr. Drew, him and his lady, they have a travel business where they take groups of people to remote areas. They've been to India. They're planning Egypt. These guys are awesome, right? And for those who just came in, Drew is a first-time father. He's a father of Liam. This is absolutely awesome, which leads me to this question, brother.
Hit me with it.
With it just being, you say past year you guys started this business, correct?
Yeah.
Now that Liam's here, will that affect your business in any way? And if so, how? Like, will you plan to take him on these travels with you? Or how will you guys go about that?
So this is a question, and this goes back to, like, what are you willing to lose? You know, it's the same, in my mind, it's the same thing. So I believe, like, with my son, you know, being the way that I think anyway, it's like a soul chooses somebody, right? So it's like, my son chose me to be his father. His soul chose me. And it's like, am I supposed to change and become somebody else other than Drew? Like, same thing. Because what does he lose? What does my son lose from his father if I change to be the idea of what it is to be a father from somebody else's heart? Yes. So, actually, I'm getting his passport. I believe we've organized the meeting for next week, and he's going overseas in April. So we're going back to the UK in April to visit some family. And I'm like, hey, let's go, you know, yalla, you know, it's like, hey, here we go. So, but he's going to be there because I would love, you know, one of the first pieces I wrote and put out was like, become the person you needed the most. And it's like, hey, if I was a kid, what would have been the fucking coolest thing that I was into? Would have been the Drew's Guide to the Galaxy kid. Which is like, my son gets to go to Egypt, gets to go to India. Like, we had a home birth here. Like, I delivered my son here. So with the help, like, we had a midwife, doula, and kid support, and it was just like, that was, I mean, so we're talking spiritual. It's like, it's everything. It's like, you know, I was away, and I was like, fuck, I really miss my son, you know? So it's like, if I can create a business where I can bring my son with me, and then I have people that can facilitate and accommodate him in these places if I need him. But it's like, I want my son there, and I want him to experience it where it's, if I could have eliminated so much negative when, you know, in your early 20s and whatnot, I could have limited so much had I known some of these things maybe that I want to teach, where it is that idea of like, you either believe in equality or you're conflicted. It's like, you have to be open to have an ear for everything.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like, I don't want to go there because of this or that. It's like, well, fuck. It's like, you can't, it's like this idea that, you know, you're limiting yourself to this culture of people and, you know, segue, but that's always been the thing. You know, I tell people where I'm traveling, oh, I would never go there. These people are like, I'm like, all right, like the fuck? And you want to tell me that, like, you're posting all this equality shit. I'm like, yo, what you just said is like super insulting to like an entire culture of people. It's like, fuck, you know?
Straight ass.
It's like,
straight ass.
Yeah. And I'm like, the most learned people in that I've, you know, mentioned some of the stuff to. It's like some of the things I've heard are just completely, you know, wild. I mean, Fancy Car Jaipur is a guy from India that just joined the thing. He's a fucking badass dude. That's my boy out there. But I'm so much, that's my journey. It's like, if I can bridge the gap, and that's why the places I choose, like we did our first group trip. We took 8 people to Turkey over the summer in August into September. And I'm there with my pregnant girl. She's like, no, we're still going.
Nice.
You know what I mean? So it's like, we show them all this stuff, went to a bunch of ancient sites, introduced them a bunch of our personal friends out there. And, you know, obviously with the news in Turkey and Syria, it's been, you know, it's heartbreaking, you know, and to be able to give back to a country that's given me so much, it's like to put people on when I'm in the country that I know, it's like, hey, we go to my boy's bar, make sure my boy gets taken care of. It's like just that old world mentality, you know, it's like, no shit. It's like, if you go to a bar and it's packed, do you just go up and order one drink or you order two and tip large? This one's fuck you. Come on.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, because the guy's going to know, oh, that's my boy. He just gave me like that simple, stupid shit. It's like where the people sometimes with the money or with everything that we all think that we need, they have no fucking clue.
Yeah.
You know, I can't get a drink in here. It's like, bro, I'm getting served at the table. Why is that? Because I treated somebody with fucking respect, please and thank you, and I tipped them large on the first fucking whatever it is, you know. So
common courtesy.
Yeah.
Common courtesy.
Yeah.
Drew, you. Needless to say, this will be the first of many conversations. I can feel it because your journey is so interesting. I am definitely ready to see what. What's next, which is Fleezy Jones segue. Next question. What is next? We got the anthology, right?
Yeah.
We got the travel business booming. Yeah. Liam has arrived. We first time father. What's next for Drew versus the galaxy? Well, Drew's guide to
that. Yeah. I think just focusing a lot on being patient, you know, and like really focusing on being patient. I want to put out more writing work. I have a bunch of new stuff I've been working on that I'd love to share a piece with you or whatever.
You better.
Yeah. So I've been working on a lot of pieces and I really want to open myself up. I do have like the spiritual business. I have like a segue business where I do help people out with trauma and stuff like that, but more in a spiritual setting and really finding solutions rather than, you know, small fixes. It's more about helping people learn how to love the world again, you know. I mean, honestly, man, that's it. Like setting intentions every day of how you're going to feel, and it's like, hey, the world's gonna fall on you. It's like, how you fucking deal with it is what matters. It's like, nothing we're experiencing in history hasn't already happened, you know. There's people that get through it somehow. It's because when shit hits a fan, it's how you deal with it. Nothing else, you know. So that's something that I'm deeply, deeply interested in exploring more. But also in the state, it's like, it's hard for me, not hard, you know, it's hard to, like I said, dance on that line of spiritual salesman and just like somebody that wants to help you out, you know. So it's like, like if I can give somebody an experience through my traveling that turns into a spiritual experience, which it always does, you know, for the clients, you know, if I can make something happen for them that is an experience that really helps them or conversate with them a little bit and get to know them and bring them out of their shell and make them feel safe in their own skin. It's like, that's the first thing. It's like, hey, like I was saying, you got to put yourself out there. But if I can't actively vocalize or write down my own thoughts, then it's all just still in here and it never leaves there, you know? So just writing in general is something, I don't care if it's journaling, you know, because if you're just thinking these words and you're not hearing yourself say them aloud, they just kind of fall apart, you know?
And that helps no one. That helps no one.
And Drew's guide is not an expert to anything. I'm that's the last thing I'd ever be. I'm like, hey, here's my experience. If you're interested in an experience or want to read some work that maybe can help you, take a look at it, you know, like with the anthology, the book In the Company of Poets, like that is an experience. Each author in there, like I'm always, it's, you know, to build a pyramid of yourself, you know, in my mind, the way I think things is like, you have to pick up the person below you to build the pyramid above you. It's like, you cannot fucking do it on your own. So it's that, it's finding that service. And I mean, it's, it took me a long time, but you know, you're going to lose people. People are going to be like, bro, like that's stupid. And it's like, well, everything, or whatever. It's like, exactly.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
when you get to that state, and I've worked hard on it, it's like, yeah, I get irritated by shit, but I also, I'm not afraid to remove negativity from my life at all costs. You know what I mean? Like, what I mean by that is like, somebody fucks me over and I can't handle, if I'm getting stressed out about it, it's like, that's it. You know,
I'm done.
If somebody owes you money or some shit, you know, it's like, don't dwell on it. It's like that line in Bronx Tale that always stuck with me. The kid, he's like, he owes you 20 bucks. Hey, you gave him 20 bucks to get rid of him, because you're never going to get it back. You know? So, or being with the wrong people, you know, it's like how we interact and learning to communicate is super important. So that's all the stuff I'm focusing on is learning to communicate with everybody and being my little, I love being a nomad and being able to travel to these places and meet people and hear their story. And if I can highlight these places for somebody else to enjoy, like it gives me so much, you know. If I can change somebody's opinion about the Middle East or, you know, New York or whatever it is, right? Mexico, doesn't matter. If I can show them something, I'm like, hey, all these things that you're scared about, like they fizzle away because there's so much notion to everything. Everybody's got a speaker for their you know, their tribe.
Yeah.
And a lot of times the speaker of that tribe is not even affiliated with anybody in it. You know what I mean? So it's like, there's a gatekeeper on poetry, or there's a gatekeeper on hip hop. There's a gatekeeper on this. It's like, well, bro, like I've never seen you at the local spot or, you know, whatever it is. It's like, what are we like, huh? You're the expert. Yeah. So it's like, if I can share an experience with somebody, it's like nobody's an expert in shit. You know, it's like, come on. It's like, science is progress. You know, it's progressive. It's always changing. You know? So, but yeah.
And with that, brother,
yeah,
we are down to the last 3 minutes. Please close me out with words from Awesome Drew.
I'm going to read you a piece from the anthology real quick.
All right.
Yeah. It's going to take me a second. Fine.
I'll take that, brother. You're going to end it off. This is how you end it all.
This is it. This is it. Okay. I'm going to read you a brokenhearted one because I love writing. Okay, this is called Hi, It's Me, We Need to Talk. I live between the lies as I laid within your sheets. I left you with an anchor of memories and mutinying the rest. Your three dimensions of ego with a one-dimensional heart. Your Joan of Arc without a crowd. A chip on your shoulder you pretend as a crown. So spoiled. The vulture can stomach the taste. A queen with a million mirrors ready to whisper everything she wants to hear. The Irish goodbye that lasts forever when no one else is around. Under the bright lights of regret, stage for the final act. Baby, it's just you and me forever, starring you, but without me.
I don't have a mic. I'm going to drop my bottle.
I tried to do it fast, but... That was in the anthology. Perfect. Yeah. Yeah.
Drew, thank you for coming to the lounge, brother. Thank you all for coming to the lounge. We're going to get up out of here. And like I always say, brothers, this was brought to you by Block Legend 7 and Living Off Good Instinct Counts. So always keep your logic. We out.
Hey, much love.
Much love.
All right, brother.
Yes, sir.